All right, Thrive Nation, on today's show, we are interviewing Kevin Jenkins of Urban Global Health about why Joe Biden's policies have only hurt Black Americans. We also deal with this controversial issue that I've seen all across this nation, Andrew, and it's rhythm therapy.
I ask him,
what can we do to stop white men from ruining dance parties everywhere?
It's a big problem.
It's a big problem.
Huge.
But we also focus on the biggest problem, which is why are Joe Biden's policies only hurting Black America?
3, 2, 1, boom. You are now entering the dojo of Mojo and the Thrive Time Show.
Thrive Time Show on the microphone. What is this? Top of the iTunes charts in the category of business. Drilling down on business topics like we are a dentist. Providing you with mentorship like you are an apprentice. And we go so fast that you might get motion sickness. Grab a pen and pad to the lab. Let's get in this. It's time to bear some fruit like some Florida oranges. 3, 2, 1. Here come the business ninjas.
Sonic boom.
Yes, 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 and yes, Thrive Nation. We are in the air everywhere, and on today's show, we are interviewing the man, the myth. I like to call him Special K, just because I want to. His name is Kevin Jenkins of Urban Global Health. Welcome onto the show, sir. How are you?
Thank you. Thank you very much for welcoming. Hey, thank you for allowing me to be on your show.
Now, brother, I have so much I want to get into with you, so I'm going to just hit you up rapid fire with a lot of questions, but before I do that, you don't need to build up your credibility with me, but for the folks out there that don't know your background, what have you been doing previous to this interview? Tell us about your career.
Well, I have 25 years, probably a little longer, in community development. You know, if you're talking about hospital acquisitions, I've been there. If you're talking about building charter schools to create a competitive market for kids to be effective human capital, been there. If you're talking about building housing for the poor, been there. If you're talking about government relations, working inside the government, understanding and interworking in the government, been there. If you're talking about lobbying governments, to lobbying this government in particular, to work with communities of color, in particular Black communities, and making sure that we have the opportunity, access to capital, to build out stronger communities where families can thrive and live, been there. So I've been blessed to be given a great opportunity in my life to do the work that we would call God's work, you know, what we would say will be our vocation. And I've been given an opportunity to do that for a lifetime. And I take it serious. I take serious what I do, because I believe that without this work, there's no future for America. There's no future for these cities. There's no future for, you know, the children that come after us. And right. I got to tell you, I've been blessed to be able to be in that space. And that's where I'm at again in my life. I thought I never would want to run another institution again, but the Urban Global Health Alliance is so critically important to the future of America and the health of America. And our focus, of course, is to build healthy communities, you know, through advocacy, education, and public policy. So, I mean, this has always been something that I've done, but I've gotten back to this, and I really thought that I would never have to do this again. It would be a younger person that would take over, but guess what? It's not happening that way. So the team that we assembled is allowed me to do some great work in a short period of time.
Now, I hate to burst anybody's bubble who's listening to this, but a lot of our listeners, it's audio only. Some watch the video, but I just want to get this clarified. I want to get this out there. Although you and I share the same worldviews, we are not biological brothers. I mean, if you follow back the family tree, we're not biological brothers. And I was doing some more research, really getting prepared for the show, and it appears as though you're Black.
Yes, I am a Black American.
Okay.
Yes.
And certain people, when you start talking about, you know, being conservative, talking about being Black, they almost act like those two ideas can't work together. So I would like you to educate folks out there of all colors listening to this show, Black people, white people. Just walk us through what's going on right now in America, because I'm seeing all these great voices come up of all different colors and backgrounds that are all talking about individual liberty. And I just want to have that discussion. Tell me about the conservatism, being Black in America, just that whole conversation. Walk us through what you see happening.
I think that's very interesting, because when I think of being conservative, I think of Frederick Douglass. When I think of being conservative, I think of Booker T. Washington. Mm. When I think of being conservative, I think of Dr. Martin Luther King. I mean, the whole fact that, you know, we are fiscally conservative, that we believe in this country, that we believe in making sure that our cities are thriving marketplaces where people can evolve and build out small businesses, where we don't want to take a handout, that we understand that the affirmative action public policies of the last 50 years has been a dismal failure. When I talk about being conservative, I come from the Black American that through Reconstruction built their own businesses, built their own banks, built their own schools. Mm. So when we think of conservative, we think of ownership. So, but what you're seeing out there in mainstream media is a distortion of what that is. So as a Black American, me sitting on here talking on a conservative show about what I value and what my principles are is foreign to them. They don't want the world to know that Black Americans, where I live at, Black Americans all around this country, ownership is primary. You know, leadership is primary. And the people that you're seeing out there talking about the handout, people that you see out there saying that, you know, we are victims. Well, I don't subscribe to that. I didn't grow up in a community of victims. I grew up in a community of leaders. So when you look at what they're showing on TV and mainstream media, it's always it's troubling to us because that's not where we sit. That's not where we come from. And they don't speak for us. There's a lot of Black Americans that are on TV now that are wholesaling garbage as hope, and that we don't subscribe to that. They have turned the word conservative into something horrible.
You know, I watched at the Republican National Convention, I watched the Attorney General for Kentucky get up there and speak. I believe he's 35 years old. And Daniel Cameron. And when he got up there to speak, I mean, my mind was blown away. I'm blown away. And I've listened to him speak. I don't think, man, there's a Black guy. Wow, there's a white guy. Wow, I just look at him as that's a great American. Help somebody out there that's trying to convince their family and their friends that it's okay to vote for your favorite basketball player, your favorite politician, your favorite values based upon the ideals and not skin color. Can you kind of help somebody out there? Because I'm sure you've probably gone through to hell and back while trying to educate those around you that it's okay to make decisions based upon other variables than just skin color.
Well, you know, the whole notion, listen, let's not fool ourselves. I mean, what we're seeing now is that they're now splitting up America based on the issue of race.
Right.
And I think there's something about that discussion that we need to have. But the way they're doing it now is counterproductive, right? So let's put that out there first. But, you know, I was a Republican all of my life, and I got very emotional when I saw Donald Trump win the first time. But I didn't quite understand it. Mm. And I have to apologize for that. I really realized that my voice should have stayed where it was. It was settled in the Republican Party. I've helped Democrats over the last some odd 15 years that I thought might have shared my values. But here's the deal. I think that any American in this country right now that's buying the narrative that if you are Republican, if you are conservative, you're anti-Christ is delusional. I think it's wrong. I think we shouldn't purchase it. I think we should run away from that. Mm. I think that we should be able to share the same stage, just like that young man did. That young man is an American story. He's a Black American story. All of those Black men and women that spoke at the RNC's convention, I thought were phenomenal human beings.
Yeah.
And we should celebrate that.
Yep.
Because I would have delivered that same message. I might have put it in a different from perspective, but their messages was, look, we are patriots. Our ancestors helped to build this country. We fought in every war. We have something in common. We want a great America so we can thrive like everyone else. Now, there are some problems with the country, but I think if we work together, we could resolve that.
Now,
that's where my head is. That's where we are right now.
Now,
and
I have
anybody that's talking about splitting this country the way they're talking about it now on mainstream
right.
media and what's happening on the streets of America. Guess what? Majority of Americans in this country, Black Americans in this country, we don't subscribe to that. We don't subscribe to that anarchy. We don't subscribe to Marxism. We don't subscribe to communism. We're saying, listen, in order for us to build this country, we have to come together.
I want to allow time. We have a guest, a kind of a secret voice. You won't be able to see him on camera, but he's a secret. He's an attorney from Manhattan who moved to Oklahoma to join our team and to help me fight some legal battles here as it relates to opening the country. But in Manhattan, I mean, it's one of the most diverse cities. Pre-COVID-19, I mean, I don't even know if you wanted to surround yourself with only a certain race of people. I don't know that you could have done that in Manhattan. It's so diverse. It's such a great melting pot. So I'm sure he has a tough question for you, but I've got a couple more questions here for you. Marxism. We all know, Everybody knows who's taken the time to research it. And if you don't know, folks, just go to timetofreeamerica.com and you can see it, okay? But we all know that George Soros, a man who admits to having grown up as a Nazi at the age of 14, on 60 Minutes, he has stated that he was a Nazi at the age of 14. And he doesn't apologize for it. We all know that George Soros, one of the most terrible humans in the history of the world, is the one funding Black Lives Matter. Think about this. A man who was a Nazi is funding Black Lives Matter. We know that the founders of Black Lives Matter are Marxists. We know that. But I don't think a lot of people know what the word Marxist means. You've done your research, Kevin. Can you please explain what the word Marxist means?
Simple. Marxism is anarchy.
Anarchy.
That's what it is.
Okay. So would you describe what's happening is that maybe the sentiment and the phrase Black Lives Matter has been hijacked by Marxist, or how would you describe
it? No, I don't think it was hijacked at all. I think it was formulated to do exactly what it's doing.
You believe it?
I don't think it was hijacked at all, actually. I don't even understand what it means. I understand what they're doing. I see what they're doing. I believe they're a part of a coup. They want to destroy this country. I think what they're pushing out in the marketplace is not beneficial to the Black community whatsoever. I still haven't figured out what their overall mission is and what their principles and values
are
whatsoever. I don't understand it. I believe that Black lives have value.
Yep.
I think that right now in this country, we need to be having an internal war in the Black community to displace some of these people that have been representing us in our community for the last 50 years that have done our community a disservice. That's a fact. If you go into the Black cities of this country, right, they have triple unemployment. They still have failing schools. They still have the highest level of healthcare disparities in the country. Yep. And guess what? At the end of the day, I can talk about systemic racism. I could talk about structural racism. I could talk about that and understand what that is. But guess what? Right now in all of these cities, and I stand with this. I've heard people say this and people get ridiculed for it. But how can you ridicule me for it when I see it in front of me every day? I live in a community that I helped build. I've been a part of the political process. I'm an insider. I understand who's responsible for this. And guess what? As my father and mother used to tell me, you have to take responsibility for your own actions. And in the Black community right now, we have to take responsibility for what's happening in our community. And we have to review those public policies that we have fostered and brought in, which has obviously destroyed the fabric of what our community should be about. And I take offense to the fact that Black Lives Matter is used as a tool to represent me as a Black American. We are not monolithic in our community whatsoever.
Now, I've seen two disturbing trends across this country over these past 39 years I've been on the planet. One is I found that the breakdown of the Black family has occurred, the fatherless family. Statistically, you look at it, where it's gone from 80% of Black children are born into a two-parent home to now it's flipped, where it's like 3 out of 4 Black children are born into a one-parent home. I want to talk about that. And I also want to talk about the problem with white culture. I noticed that the dance moves at weddings are getting worse. So I'm going to talk about that in a moment. And it's getting bad. And somebody needs to sound the alarm. Someone needs to do something.
Okay.
It'll be a rhythm therapy. I can see it happening. We can find the beat. We can do it. We'll get to that in a minute. But I want to ask you this. What's going on? What's going on with the breakdown of the family? What is happening? Why is it happening? What's happening?
Let me just say this, though. As a Black American man that grew up with a mother and father and grew up in a community that loved me, I grew up with 5,000, 10,000 parents. I grew up, my mother comes from a very big family. My father comes from a very big family. So I had, let's just suggest I had 24 parents. Mm. And what has happened from the later 70s to right now, there's been a all-out assault from my perspective, from the policies that were created from the Democratic Party to destroy the family.
Wow.
This whole thing, prison to pipeline, the prison industrial complex, that was the destruction of the Black male in this country. And if you looked at what happened at the DNC conference, I looked at it closely, and I try not to really watch, but I wanted to see, they're still pushing the same narrative, the victimhood narrative, that guy around the corner is your enemy, when in fact, we have some internal things we have to build in our community. I grew up in a community that had fathers, that had uncles, that had a solid base. Mm. So what happened after a certain period of time, and I would suggest around the late 70s and 80s, through the policies of Bill Clinton, who I was once a supporter of, right? Those policies have eviscerated the Black community. And we need to take responsibility for that. And just like the war on drugs, you know, the mass incarceration that occurred in that period of time,
yeah,
it wiped us out. It wiped us off the planet. And on top of all the other policies that, you know, this affirmative action policies that as a kid I actually agreed with, but now I'm directly opposed to.
Now, Kevin, we'll get into this rhythm therapy thing that I'm really trying to launch an all-out war against Caucasians all over across the nation who just cannot find the beat. What's your favorite old school jam? If you had to pick a favorite old school jam, what was the hit? What was the jam?
I'm a Marvin Gaye guy.
Okay. All right. So Marvin Gaye. So let me just get some. Let me just make sure the listeners understand what I'm doing here. I'm gonna go to Marvin Gaye. Now Marvin Gaye did a lot of great songs. But we're gonna do "Got to Give It Up." Okay. Now this is what's going on here, folks. So I'm gonna hit play here. Let me hit play, and I'm gonna cue it up here. Here we go. Now you want to be on that beat right there. You just want to.
Right.
And then, but this is like, now.
You got a good beat.
But there's a lot of these white guys out there who are like swatting at bees, and they're going, where is it? I don't see it. I can't find it. And I think, you know, you become the average of the five people you spend the most time with. And so I just feel like the listen, if the folks out there, if you can help me, we got to stop this epidemic. We got to stop this crisis. You got to play some R&B in your living room. Otherwise, your kids are going to grow up to be the kind of men that swat bees on the dance floor. They ruin the mojo. You can't do a Soul Train line with them. It's not a good thing. So I'm just, as a former DJ, I wanted to get that out there. Would you agree that's a great way to indoctrinate your kids with clapping on beat is making sure you play some Marvin Gaye in the house? Or what would be your tip?
I don't know about that, but I got to tell you this, though. If they're playing Marvin Gaye in the house, they got great music taste.
All right. That's great. Now, James, I'm going to get your intro music queued up here. This is, folks, if you're not familiar with James, he's an incredible attorney. He's from Manhattan. He has moved to Tulsa, Oklahoma to do some comeback.
Yes, sir.
He's ready to file some lawsuits. He has moved from New York to Oklahoma. He's now in Oklahoma. James, welcome onto the show. What questions do you have for the man, the myth, Special K?
All right, Special K. I'm the lawyer James from Manhattan, new to Tulsa. Been here for a little bit over a month. Nice to meet you.
All right. Nice to meet you.
Thank you. Well, just this little vignette about the Motown thing. My father used to wake us up at 7 o'clock in the morning with Musicarium by Stevie Wonder. And I remember
Stevie
the song.
Wonder, that's yeah. Right.
Do I Do? That was the song.
Can
that,
you clap on beat?
You know, that's one of my favorite ones, you know.
Yeah, it's one of mine, too. I really like it a lot. And I saw him in concert, Stevie Wonder. He came to Madison Square Garden a few years ago. And I splurged and got. There we go.
I just want to ask you, I'm serious, don't play games with me.
But the first line he says, when I see you down the street, which is kind of confusing.
Listen, don't play the game. Don't be wasting Kevin's time. I'm asking you, can you clap on beat?
Oh, yeah. I can clap on beat, snap on beat,
the whole
dance
deal.
On beat, all that stuff.
Okay, oh, yeah. I don't want this to stop.
There we go. Oh,
okay.
So good.
Okay, back to you.
Yeah, all right. So,
hey, listen, you're talking about both of my favorites, Stevie Wonder and Marvin Gaye, out of Motown. Come on.
And both of you guys can clap on beat. Am I correct?
100%.
We got to stop this.
Clap on beat.
We got to stop this epidemic. James, what question do you have for Special K?
All right, so I've got two groups of people, I guess, as we all do. I know people who are misinformed, and I know people who are informed. And I find that the misinformed, they base their decisions on reading headlines, on the opinions of others, and on emotions, and they completely ignore the facts for one of two reasons. Number one, they don't know that those facts exist, or number two, they've got blinders on. So my question for you is, you know, do you come across I'll call them the misinformed? And if so, how do you get the message across? Because that's been my biggest difficulty, is getting the message across. And I'm losing friends as soon as I talk about this mask loss, this lawsuit that we filed in Tulsa to repeal the mask mandate.
Well, you know, that's interesting because, you know, I created this Facebook page called The Informed Class. And in The Informed Class, I share a lot of information, data, science. I share a lot of political, you know, narratives all from all around the world. And, you know, there's some people that subscribe to it. I think our job is to educate, advocate, you know, and deal with policies that either help us or don't help us. And I think there's some people that are just going to be lost. I got to be honest, I've come to the conclusion that the people that are hungry, the people that are intellectually curious, the people that want to stay free or be free, to be a free citizen, to be a free thinker, those are the people that are going to always be aligned with us. and the people that have accepted their indoctrination, you know, and I'm not seeking a greater, you know, a greater vision for themselves as a community individual. Some of those people, I hate to break the bad news to you, they're not going to survive this. You know, think about what's getting ready to happen now. Right now, they're turning our schools into indoctrination camps. Right now, yep. They are now talking about commoditizing our bodies for the pharmaceutical industry. Right now, big tech now is becoming our doctor as opposed between the doctor and the patient. Right now, our children are being masked up, even though that the science and data did clearly qualifies that our children are not a health risk for us. Right now, you have the teacher, I call it the, what was the term that I used? The education cartel now destroying public education as we know it.
True.
Right now, we have, 12 to 24 major wealthy people in this world now dictating and controlling our government. We have a problem. And the problem is that we don't continue to keep having these conversations and bridging that gap. We won't have a society to talk about. We won't have this transcendent democracy.
And more Stevie Wonder and more Marvin Gaye.
Excuse me?
And more Stevie Wonder and more Marvin Gaye, too.
Yeah, absolutely. Both of them were trendsetters. They talked about what was happening in their time. So the question for me is, what's happening with us? We need to define our leadership. We need to lend our voice to what's happening out here. And we need to all work together. That's why I'm loving doing this show, because we're speaking to different audiences. So, you know, I'm not here promoting Black Lives Matter. I'm here promoting the future of what Black communities should look like. But I'm also saying that if the white guy or the white immigrant or the people that have helped to build this country, we don't work together, forget about our constitutional rights, forget about our medical freedoms, forget about religious freedoms,
yep.
Forget about it all. It's over.
You know, I want to, before I ask you my next question, I want people to think deeply for a second. Just for a second. Just, I know we're all busy, and I know that, you know, think about this for a second.
Oh, yeah.
Think, yeah. What is Marvin saying? Far too many of you dying. Okay, I got it. All right, here we go. You know we've got to find a way to bring some loving here today. Father, Father, we don't need to escalate. We don't need to escalate. Now, I want to make sure we're getting this. There was a time, if you can believe it, back in the day, folks, people would actually listen to the lyrics of songs. People would actually listen to the lyrics of songs. The song says, Father, 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 we don't need to escalate. Now, if we contrast that to, let's say, any song at all by Post Malone, any song at all that Post Malone does. I mean, you could choose whatever Post Malone song you want. Post Malone is doing songs about shooting people, about doing drugs, while shooting people. The stuff that Post Malone sings about, it's truly crazy stuff. And so I think what we have to do is we now have to take this moment here with Kevin, and we need to recalibrate and ask ourselves, what is truth? What is true? What do we need to be listening to? Who is right? Who is wrong? Who should our heroes be? What should be our true north? What is our moral compass? And I think Kevin encompasses all of these things. Kevin believes in individual liberty. He believes in the Constitution. He believes that we are all given in certain unalienable rights from our Creator, and that the Constitution was created to uphold those rights, and that the people, you and I watching this show, listening to this show, we give freely certain rights to the government. We say, government, we're going to allow you to serve us to uphold these rights. We believe that these elected officials get their rights from us. They get their power from us. They get the right. They get their power from the consent of the governed. We believe all these things, but we've got to stop listening to Post Malone. We've got to stop listening to Dr. Fauci. We've got to stop listening to Gavin Newsom. We got to stop listening to the mayor of New York, who Bill de Blasio, whose his name is actually not Bill de Blasio. We got to recalibrate and ask ourselves, what is the truth? Where is the truth? I believe I get the truth from the Bible, from the Constitution, from their founding fathers, from great leaders like Frederick Douglass. Kevin, I want to ask you, if the listeners out there want to get the truth, give us a website, give us a resource, give us someplace we can go to escape Post Malone and his nonsense. Where can we go to hear the truth, to find the truth? Where can we direct people to where they can discover the truth that you know?
Well, at our institution, Urban Global Health Alliance, you know, you can always go to the urbanglobalhealthalliance.com, where we have bigger conversations about, you know, health in this country. But there are a lot of good patriots out here. There are a lot of great patriots out here that have different podcasts and different shows. You got Joe Otto out in Colorado. You have a number of people. You have Candace Edwards down in Boston. I just left speaking at a rally there. You have Marsha, her name is escaping me, down in Virginia. So we have a lot of people that we've built an alliance with around this country. So I'm quite sure if you're in any part of that country, you have Tara Thornton with the Freedom Angels. She works closely. She's a partner in the Urban Global Health Alliance, Suiting Sweeting in New Jersey. We have people all over the country that are working and have different podcasts, just like yourself, that are talking about how do we save our democracy? How do we fight back against this tyranny? How do we fight to protect our medical freedoms? How do we fight to protect our humanity? How do we fight to protect our children from the education cartel? We have a lot of great Americans out there fighting that are black, that are white, that are female, that are black female. We're out there doing it. But the thing is this. We have an institution, we have corporations that are spending $1 trillion worldwide to indoctrinate our people into fear. So what you saw in Germany was, guess what? That was what we should be about. What we're seeing in Denmark, that's what we should be about. What's getting ready to happen in London again next week, that's what we should be about. Yep. We should be all unifying, no matter what our race is, at this present moment in history, to fight for what we all fought for, a free country. A free country where we can control our government. Because what we're seeing now is our churches have abandoned us, but God hasn't. What we're seeing now, our governments that we actually formed are now working against us. So we have to move past our fear. We have to start working together. We have to push back against all of the spooky people and the negative stuff that's now saying that we have to be against each other. That's what the mask is. To me, the mask is the mask of despair. That's why I'm pushing. That's why I talk about the mask all the time. That is not there to make you healthy. That is there to keep you trapped in despair. So guess what? Wherever you can find the truth that's based in some spiritual or religious, when I say spiritual, with a spiritual background or moral background, we should be following that.
You know, I would say, folks, so just to give you some statistics here to back what Kevin is stating, Dr. Dan Erickson, who we've had on the Thrive Time show, he has stated that the death rate from COVID-19 is now 0.02%, and that was before the CDC came out. The CDC came out and said, hey, only 6% of those who've died with COVID-19 have died from COVID-19. Let me put it this way. Only 6% of the big total you keep hearing of all the people actually died as a direct result of COVID-19, which means the remaining 94% of people that died with COVID-19 died from an average of 2.3 comorbidities, and they also happened to have COVID at the time of death. So all these statistics, the models that came out originally predicted that 2.2 million people would die. Remember those models from Neil Ferguson and the Abdul Latif Jameel Institute? Kevin, you remember those? They said 2.2 million people would die. Now they've said those models were off by 25 times. They've been saying for the longest time, we got to wait for a vaccine. Now, the former top advisor for Governor Rick Perry of Texas, Dr. Richard Bartlett, who served Governor Rick Perry for 7 consecutive years, has now said that he's treated hundreds of people with FDA-approved medications involving budesonide, Pulmicort, and it's unbelievable, a Z-Pak and a nebulizer. So a nebulizer, budesonide, Pulmicort, and a Z-Pak. $237, folks, is what it costs if you don't have insurance. Dr. Richard Bartlett's coming out saying, hey, everyone I've treated hasn't died. So we just keep hearing over and over that these people are lying to us. But I know there's somebody watching right now, and you're scared. Somebody is scared.
Well, they're afraid because they're tuned into Big Pharma TV, Big Tech TV every day. They're watching. Look, this is the first time in my life that I have to actually admit that when I was growing up in the epicenter of 1963, right, we had some, at least, you know, houses of journalism that were trying to speak the truth and cover the story the right way. Now that does not happen. That's over. Anybody that trusts anything that's on TV right now, mainstream media, is doing themselves a disservice.
Do you
they're actually working against us every day.
Now, this is interesting. I want to read the, real quick the lyrics of this one more time. Marvin Gaye, okay, what's going on? He says, picket lines and picket signs. Don't punish me with brutality. Talk to me so you can see what's going on. Okay, so that's his lyrics. They make sense. They're positive. Now let's go to Post Malone, Rockstar. This is interesting. He says, effing with me, call up on an Uzi and show up, man them the shottas. When my homies pull up on your block, they make that thing go. These are the people we're listening to now. We are now listening to Post Malone. Joe Biden just did an interview with Cardi B. Cardi B's new song, WAP. I want to read the lyrics to you folks that you would know that your kids shouldn't be listening to this song.
But the question is, why would the industry even promote anything like that?
It's crazy.
You think about that. The record industry has become an abomination. Marvin Gaye would never be able to thrive in this marketplace. Think about it. We're in the middle of something so evil and so insidious. And what does the industry does? It puts that out.
Right.
That's the message that they're putting out. And that's the message we should be fighting back against. Listen, I live in a community that of people that we might be split in a lot of areas,
yep.
But guess what? Any mother, any father, any more person with a moral voice, we should be rallying against that. She should not be on any TV. She should not be recorded whatsoever. It does not represent who we are as a people.
So you don't think that Cardi B should be the person that Vice President, former Vice President, now presidential candidate Joe Biden should be sitting down with to do an interview? I mean, you don't think that Cardi B is a leading voice in America?
I think it's horrible. Absolutely not.
Unbelievable. So
absolutely not. Think about that. A president who can't. But see, that says a lot about the party that he represents.
Right.
The party that my family was involved in. That right now, that party that I've watched morph into the tool of the oligarchs, because that's who's running that party now. I can always say something about the Republican Party, but my people have invested 95% into the Democratic Party, and we have no return on it. Our returns on investment has been zero. And the mere fact that that presidential candidate would sit down with Cardi B, someone that has confessed, literally confessed that she drugged men and took their money, and someone in the middle of a world crisis, a world meltdown, that would put a song out there, that says a lot about the industry, and it shows that they have no compassion for black young people in this country. They don't.
What do you think about, Billie Eilish. They bring up Billie Eilish to speak at the DNC. I'm going to read the lyrics to one of her hit songs that actually made it to the radio. It's called All the Good Girls Go to Hell. These are the lyrics. I'm reading the lyrics. It says, my Lucifer is lonely, standing there killing time, can't commit to anything but a crime. Peter's on vacation, an open invitation, animals evidence, pearly gates look more like a picket fence. Once you get inside them, got friends but can't invite them. Hills burn in California, my turn to ignore ya. Don't say I didn't warn ya. All the good girls go to hell. Because even God herself has enemies. And once the water starts to rise and the heavens out of sight, she'll want the devil on her team. I mean, we are talking about openly satanic people appearing at the Democrat National Convention. We're not even going to get in today into their logo now featuring a pentagram. I mean, we could go on and on. What is going on with the Democrat Party there, Kevin? What is going on with these people? Are these people just outspoken satanic people? How nuts are these people?
Well, I can't speak personally for everybody that's a Democrat. I'm quite sure there's some Democrats that probably have a problem with that.
Yeah.
But as a party, they are not the party of the 1960s.
True.
I got to be honest with you. Even in the 1960s, they were not the party that black Americans should be subscribing to, if you understand what the Dixiecrats have done or the role that they played in creating policies that suppress the value of black Americans in this country. But here's the deal. The Democratic Party at this present moment and what they have done in the last 12 months, because I've been around the country talking to a lot of Democrats that are elected leaders. They are presently working hand in hand with some of the most evil people on this planet to take our freedoms away from us. Now, that's hard for me. That's very difficult for me to say, but it's a fact. It is an absolute fact.
Somebody out there needs to be educated, and that might even be me. just briefly walk us through, because the lie that's out there is that the Democrats, they love the downtrodden. They love the poor white people. They love the poor black people. They love the poor Hispanic people. They, if you are going through a funk, they love you. That's the line that we've been, and then the Republicans, this is the line, I don't agree, but this is the line. The line we've been told, the line we've been sold, the tagline is, Republicans, they don't care. They don't care about you. They forgot about you. But yet the reality is a very different story. Can you just give us a quick, because you're so educated on this, can you give us a quick history lesson on the history of the Republican Party?
Well, the history of the Republican Party?
Yeah.
Well, as far as a black American, the Republicans, I mean, when you talk about, you know, Lincoln, when you talk about Grant, when you talk about Reconstruction, that was the party that shepherded us out of slavery, right, to a new economic, economic future for black Americans. And the Democratic Party at that time in history was the party that was directly opposed to black Americans moving, you know, out of slavery into a global, an economy that would be able to allow us to have ownership of our own lives. So at the end of the day, I mean, the history speaks for itself. Now, what the Republican Party has allowed to happen and what the Republican Party has gotten away from is those principles that I believe made a greater party than the Democratic Party. Now, I've helped Democrats, I've helped Republicans, I've helped people that are free thinkers, I've invested in both parties, right? But now what I'm seeing from the Democratic Party is a complete takeover by the global elite. They don't care about you. They want you, they will turn your bodies over to those corporations. They will commoditize your bodies for their wealth. And you could see it on your mainstream media. You could see it with the government officials that are running these governors that are running these states right now. It has been a complete takeover of the Democratic Party.
When you say commoditize your bodies, what do you mean by that?
Okay, so let me give you an example. You know, as a black American, I understand that slavery in this country, right? We, as a slave, my body was commoditized to build this country.
Got
it. We were free labor.
Okay.
Labor Day. Labor Day is the day where we were free labor in this country.
Mm.
What I'm seeing now is right now at this present moment, Big Pharma and Big Tech in partnership with the Democratic Party has developed a strategy to use our bodies, and I'm using vaccines as a gateway for this discussion, to now turn over our bodies to those industries for their wealth. So they're commoditizing on my body yet again. Now they're going to commoditize on your body. They're going to commoditize on our children's body. We're now we are now the instrument for their wealth. Commodity and wealth control, that's what we have become.
You are blowing my mind. I feel like you could be on a show for 7 consecutive hours, and every minute of that you would just mind expanding, and I appreciate you taking time out of your Labor Day to be here with us. So what I want to do is I want you to, you have the mic, and before you drop it, you can say anything you want to our listeners, but our listeners are big into calls to action. They want to do something. So is there a website they need to go to? Is there a form to fill out? Is there a pledge to sign? What do our listeners need to do?
Well, this is what I want you to do. I want you to go to the UrbanGlobalHealthAlliance.com. You know, we're about building healthy communities. We're about advocating for our communities, every community, not just the black community, but every community. We're about organizing communities around the issues of health and building strong communities. We're working on right now building a national clergy alliance. Right now, we're building a parent union across this country to advocate for parents that are being trapped and being manipulated to turn their kids' bodies over as a commodity. We just don't talk about vaccines. We talk about the totality of the human being. Mm-hmm. And we're also fighting back and pushing back against these policies that are going to have a direct impact on our children's lives. So the Urban Global Health Alliance .com is called UrbanGlobalHealthAlliance.com. Please go there, sign up. We're talking about empowering communities all around this country. And now we're going to be moving globally because what's happening around the world, people are pushing back. But let me tell you another call to action.
Yeah.
I want all of us at home sitting down right now to take a deep breath and look around about what's happening. We don't have the luxury of not working together. We have to work together. We have to come together in every community. If you're talking about opening up your government, if you're talking about saving your children from Big Pharma and Big Tech, if you're talking about protecting your child from the education cartel, if you're talking about how to save your communities, how to keep your small businesses intact. Right now, our government is working against us. Right now, at this second. And we have to fight back and we have to push back together. Don't let them fool you with Black Lives Matter. Don't let them fool you with all of this other, you know, stuff that's happening in your cities.
Yep.
Know without a shadow of a doubt that this is a coup that's occurring. It is a coup.
It's a coup.
That's exactly what it is. It is. Call it what it is.
Kevin, thank you so much for being here on the show. And again, folks, if you have not yet checked out the website, it's UrbanGlobalHealthAlliance.com. That's UrbanGlobalHealthAlliance.com. Again, Kevin, thank you for being on today's show.
Thank you, my friend.
And now, without any further ado,
3, 2, 1, boom!
Why does this still keep happening to me? I don't know whose prayer I'm breaking into, but I'm breaking into somebody's prayer saying, Lord, why do I keep going through the same things over and over again? And the Lord sent me here to tell you the problem is with your default. Until you change your default, you will always go back to being who you were before because you have never changed your mind. You change your friends, you change your address, you change your phone number, you change the songs you sing, you change everything else, but you didn't change your mind. There is nothing as powerful as a changed mind.
Boom!
Nothing as powerful as a changed mind.
Boom!
Better get yours, cause I'ma take mine.
Boom!
Leave them where they got if they ain't ready. Used to have a lot of homies, now they dropping like a belly. I'm like,
boom!
We taking over, it's our time now.
Boom!
Oh, you ain't know, we about to thrive now. Big, overwhelming, optimistic, momentum, eighth place.
Hey!
Back, let me get them.
Go get them then!
Hurdle every obstacle, trying to do the impossible. Turned my whole life around, haters thought it was comical. Had to make some moves, didn't even seem logical. Quarterback to play, man, I had to call an audible. Drop back, stop that, rearrange or switch it up. Only got one life to live, it's best that you go live it up. Beg you, ain't an option, ain't no way that I can give it up. Hey, knowledge, go pick it up. Nothing like your posse, look poppy, you cannot top me. They watch me and try to copy like Rocky, you cannot stop me. Holier than ever, we grinding all through the weather. We shining because we better get with us, leave out our cheddar.
Whoa.
Once I change my mind, dog, trust me, ain't no going back. Coming for that top spot, I'm feeling like they owe me that.
Whoa.
Time for us to level up, I feel like we've been holding back. Throw your hands up, say it with me if you're going down.
Boom.
Nothing as powerful as a changed mind.
Boom.
Better get yours, cause I'ma take mine.
Boom.
Leave them where they got if they ain't ready. Used to have a lot of homies, now they dropping like a belly. I'm like,
boom.
We taking over, it's our time now.
Boom.
Oh, you ain't know, we about to thrive now. Big, overwhelming, optimistic, momentum.
Hey,
Clay,
hey,
back, let me get them. Yeah. Came a long way from where I used to be.
I used to
home, leave to see life the way I used to see it.
Hold
habits die hard, but you gotta leave them.
Man.
If they ain't riding like a Harley, then you don't need them. You're cheering and you're clapping, I don't need that. Fake friends, treat them like fat Joe, make them lean back. Sight, but no vision, make you blind, I can see that.
Anything I think up in my mind, I can achieve that.
Whoa. I can make a milli if I want to.
I want to.
I'ma keep it real, cause I want to. Other women try to holler, girl, I want you. And disrespecting wifey's what I won't do. Gon' do your dance, gon' do your dance. If you really wanna change, gotta have a plan. Even when they sit down, I'ma take a stand. Throw your hands up, say it with me, if you know it, man.
Beliefs become your thoughts, thoughts become your actions.
Whoa.
So be intentional about where your passion
Whoa.
Is focused. There's no hocus pocus. We only live once, man, and you know this. You can't press the rewind, but you can make a beeline to the next level like you're headed for the tree line. I was born in Minnesota, moved to Oklahoma, incorporated both into my rhymes. Now it's time to show ya how a former stuttering student can turn out the raps with a lyrical miracle flow in the cash to match. Yeah, I'm important, a Minnesota refugee, but I'm consistent as can be as I rap on hip-hop beats, bringing rappers and tax. Even though that I'm wise, I can play that folky music, but I ain't vanilla ice. Here we go, here we go, here we go, full scream. 3, 2, 1, dynamite on the scene.
Boom.
Nothing as powerful as a changed mind.
Boom.
Better get yours, cause I'ma take mine.
Boom.
Leave them where they got if they ain't ready. Used to have a lot of homies, now they dropping like a belly. I'm like,
boom.
We taking over, it's our time now.
Boom.
Oh, you ain't know, we about to thrive now. Big, overwhelming, optimistic, momentum. Boom.
And the Lord sent me here to tell you the problem is with your default. Until you change your default, you will always go back to being who you were before because you have never changed your mind. You change your friends, you change your address, You change your phone number. You change the songs you sing. You change everything else, but you didn't change your mind. There is nothing as powerful as a changed mind.
Hear the rest of T.D. Jakes. Incredible, life-changing, and mind-altering sermon. Nothing as powerful as a changed mind today. By looking up T.D. Jakes on YouTube and typing in, nothing as powerful as a changed mind.
Santa, you're getting ready to flow. I feel the glory.
That is a Lyrical Miracle Rap